All right. On that note, I think we're ready to get started here. First of all, thanks as always for being here, you guys, for our second episode of Season 2, Line Change with Coach Thomas. For those of you who don't know, the way this show goes is I'm just going to sort of recap the previous weekend. I'll ask a few questions to the gentleman sitting to my right. Then I'll open up the floor for discussion. You guys are all free to ask whatever question your heart desires. The only thing we ask is that you do please ask your questions into the microphone here. Also, if you would be so kind as to sort of pass the mic around when that section does come, we'd appreciate it. We just want to make sure everyone's questions are heard and are good to go on our archived version on YouTube. And then we'll just sort of wrap the show up at the end by previewing the upcoming weekend we have coming up this Friday and Saturday night at the Macon Centerplex. So, Coach, first thing I want to ask you is, this past weekend, opening weekend, now in the books, the Mayhem took 3 points of a possible 4. Overall, pretty good start to the season. From opening weekend, what were some of the biggest strengths and weaknesses that you gathered from the team?
Well, obviously, the first two games are going to be a lot of sloppy hockey and stuff like that. I thought the first game was just up and down, a lot of turnovers, and we couldn't bury on our chances and stuff like that. But I think my group really showed in the second game what we're capable of. I think that was probably the best game I've seen my team play as a whole, for over the last 2 years. It was a great game. They battled from, the drop of the puck all the way to the end of the game. So got a lot of positive stuff out of it. And, the negative stuff I kind of knew was going to happen, it being so early in the season. So, but we just got to build off it every day and get better.
Right, and not only did you guys battle in terms of the scoreboard, but you battled in terms of nearly losing appendages. Before I shift the focus to these two gentlemen to your right, I want to talk about Ryan Devine and what happened there. He took a high stick to the face in between his mouth and his nose, from what I've been told. Mm-hmm. There was a trail of blood leading from the incident all the way to the locker room. Can you maybe go into a little more detail about what happened in the locker room afterward, and can you shed some light on what his status is going forward?
Yeah, that's a scary thing to see. Nobody knew exactly what happened. We didn't know if it was a skate or anything like that. So in the room, I kind of went in there after the period. Docs were all around him, and they were checking him out, and he ended up getting about 7 or 8 stitches in his lip and broke his nose. He's a tough kid, though. The kid wanted to come back out. He got fixed up. We put a cage on him, and he was begging me to come back out for the third period. So, kid's a warrior. Unfortunately, he does need surgery. Mm-hmm. So, we'll probably put him on the IR here for 3 weeks.
Okay.
But it's an injury where once it's fixed, it'll take about 2 weeks to get back. So, I think the safest thing to do is just to get him healed up. I got some bodies here now, so we'll get him healed up, and he'll be back in a few weeks.
Is he going to keep the bubble on after he comes
back?
Yeah,
he has to. Yeah. I'll make sure he has to keep that on until it's fully healed. So,
well, not too many other sports would you see somebody who gets his nose cut open and then returns to the ice or returns to the game before the game's over. So really impressive stuff from Ryan Devine this past weekend. I think he showed a lot of heart. I'm going to shift the focus now to the two players we have on hand here who, by the way, Jimmy Soper and Stathis Soumalidis, recently appointed alternate captains for your 2019-20 Macon Mayhem. Soumy, I'm going to address the first question to you here. You got into a fight with Chance Braid before the third period even started. The puck dropped, and just like that, you two were going at it. When was it decided that you two were going to drop the gloves?
I think it was right from the hop because I think he hit Minerva behind the net, like the first shift. And then he was just running around pretty much the whole game. And so I asked him earlier a couple times, but he was always tired, I guess. So he would always have an excuse or something. So and before the third period started, I asked him to go. But I told him he has no excuse right now because he can be tired after the break. So I asked Leo if it's a good time to go, and Leo gave me the green light, so that's how it all started.
So how's your hand doing after that?
No, hand is fine. A little swollen, but
yeah.
I think it's from I hit his helmet a couple times. So, but yeah, hand is fine.
Right. So, Jimmy, you ended up actually scoring a goal just 3 minutes after the fact. Now, I've heard from several people that sometimes it does raise team morale when there's a fight. Sometimes it doesn't. Did that raise the team morale? Did it raise your morale?
I think we were all kind of expecting it because we saw him asking all game. And, you could tell as soon as Sumi went on the ice to start the third, you know, everyone was standing. Fans were into it. And it brought a lot of life for the third period. And I thought we thrived off it. So it was a big start for us.
It was, and it would stand as the game-winning goal. You guys played a tremendous defensive game, I thought, especially in the third period after an up-and-down opening night on Friday. So the next question I want to ask is for both you two. You were, like I said earlier, you were both recently appointed alternate captains for the team this season. You're on a team full of veterans, lots of players on this team who have been in this league for a long time, and yet you guys are pretty young. You're 24 and 25 years old. What does it mean to you to be alternate captains for this organization?
Yeah, it's obviously an honor and a privilege. You see, look around the dressing room, and there is a lot of leaders, a lot of older guys, and even guys that I still look up to. So to have a letter on the jersey is an honor, and something that, you know, I cherish, and I hope to earn, well, not earn, but show the other guys that I can be a leader and take charge out there.
Yeah, definitely. You know, we still, even though we're the alternate captains, there's a lot of guys on the team that even that could probably wear the ladder, you know, that all lead by example. So we have a lot of guys that could wear the ladder, I guess, this year.
Sure. Okay, last question I have for you two, and then I'll let the fans ask some questions. I need to ask this. When did this epic ping pong rivalry of yours start? And why did it start?
I think it started last year, really. Sumi was the only guy I couldn't beat, so I took the challenge, and it took all the way until today to actually beat him in a series. So
you beat today
was a big one.
That was your first time?
First time in beating him in a three-game series.
And we could hear it. We could hear it in the locker room. That's how pumped he was. It was pretty good.
Yeah, I think that's a lot of it has to do with my hand. It's from the fight that I'm hurt. So, but yeah.
Yeah, he brought his book of excuses this morning. So.
Now, Steven Pirog is the self-proclaimed best ping pong player on the team. Do you two have anything to say about that?
Not a chance.
I haven't seen him play, but okay. I'm gonna call it garbage on that one.
Well, we're thinking about having a mayhem ping pong tournament. The only issue that we're possibly running into is making it a mandatory event where the whole team has to go. I don't know how many guys would want to stay after practice for a couple hours and do that, but I think it could be a lot of fun. What are your guys' thoughts on that?
Yeah, there's a lot of guys that actually want to play after practice, but me and Jimmy just don't let anybody play.
Oh, you hog the table,
yeah.
Eh? I can confirm. All right, guys, so the next portion of the show is going to belong to you. Like I said earlier, you can ask any question your heart desires, voice any comment, concern, complaint your heart desires as well. Like I said, the only thing we ask is that you do please do so into the microphone here. DJ, if I could trouble you to pass it around a little bit, that would be appreciated. And the floor is yours. Okay.
Leo, do you think the one-game suspension was adequate, or do you think he deserved more?
Honestly, I think he deserves more. I mean, when a guy's hurt that bad and he's needs surgery and he's going to be out for almost a month, it shouldn't be one game. So,
do you think it was intentional after seeing that video?
Yeah.
It looked like it on the video.
No, it was. And that's why when I saw it, I clipped it real quick and sent it to the head of officiating and sent him an email and everything. And to me, that's more than a game, but something that's out of my hands. So, I think we can deal with that next time we play them, and you know, and just go from there. Yeah, we know who it is. So.
This actually goes to the players. How bad was the urge to have a stray puck hit the referee in the forehead?
Did that actually happen?
You know, there's highs and lows with the officiating within games, periods, and that's something that I think we're going to try and do a better job of this year, is just trying to keep our composure and control what we can control. So, yeah, again, you know, there's heat of the moment and stuff, and you'd like to do stuff and say stuff that you can't do. It just hurts you in the long run. So I think we're just going to try and control what we can control more often.
It can't just be an oops.
Nah, they'll get in a lot of trouble for that. I need my players. That's like a 20-game suspension. Well, maybe not if that guy got one. I don't know.
Yeah.
Hey, Coach. On Friday, the trips to the penalty box really detracted from the team's ability to win, whereas Saturday, it felt like the refs allowed both teams to play their game to the fullest extent. So I was actually wondering what your thoughts on the comparison contrast to Friday and Saturday.
Yeah, Friday was, before you walked in, I think we were kind of talking about it, but Friday, it being the first game of the season, you're expecting, you know, some missed calls or bad bounces, stuff like that. So, you know, some of the calls I thought were questionable, but he also did miss some that I thought were, that should have been called. So it was a little inconsistent, but both teams were battling. It was like 40-something shots to 40-something. So, you know, we're just glad we could get out of there with at least 1 point. So.
There were 89 shots on goal on Friday night, for those of you wondering. I don't think that'll happen every game.
I hope not. 48 for us would be good.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So Sean O'Brien's not here. I'm sure all of you guys have noticed that. And he's always, you know, filled to the brim with questions. So he texted me four of his questions that he wants answered tonight. I'll ask one of them now. I believe this one's addressed to Coach. He said, I didn't see Saturday's game, but based on Friday and the comments from both Saturday and the preseason game, Soper looks like a different player in the offensive zone. He still hits everything that moves, but is generating more scoring chances and starting to drive possession. Was there anything different he focused on during the off season? Is it better chemistry with Cameron, Timofeyev, and others playing wing instead of center?
So I think that's a question for him then, right?
Probably.
Okay.
Yeah.
This summer I changed my training, did a lot of more puck skills and shooting the puck. Just tried to kind of enhance my skill side of the game, but I don't think I'll ever stop hitting. I enjoy that part of the game and always looking to do that.
And I'll make sure he hears that answer. So it's getting recorded. Anything else, guys? It looks like DJ's got one here. DJ, do you have one, or do you want me to? I can read another Sean question here. Okay. Okay, so Sean asks, Stathis still has an A, is still the top line winger, and is still a talented veteran, but does this season feel different than previous ones, as a lot around him has changed, line mates, other leaders on the team, etc.? Sure, yeah. Stathis still has an A, is still the top line winger, and is still a talented veteran, but does this season feel different than previous ones, as a lot around him has changed, line mates, other leaders on the team, etc.?
A little different, but I used to play with Steven Pirog for 2 years, basically, so me and him are playing together again, and it doesn't really feel any different than what the chemistry we used to have.
Right.
It feels pretty much the same.
And Did you guys play on a line together in the 2017 season when the team won the championship? Were you often paired up?
Pretty much the whole year.
Really?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I guess as a follow-up question to that, how did you enjoy playing with Darius Davidson along with Steven Pirog as a younger player? I think he's probably the same age you were when you came into the league.
Oh, it's good. Mm-hmm. Both me and Pirog really enjoy playing with him. He's, you know, both him and Pirog really fast skaters, which I need in my line because I'm not a fastest skater. Mm-hmm. So I really enjoy that.
Jimmy seemed to enjoy you humbling yourself there a little bit.
Hey, Jimmy. On Saturday, you were in the game's second star. How do you feel the team as a whole were able to grind out those two goals, especially the second one, which you were the benefactor of?
Yeah, I mean, we had chances during the game, and I think it was actually on a line change, and Pirog, and they were doing a great job. I'm not sure who else was with him, but cycling in the corner, and I just kind of found a spot, and he made a great pass and allowed me to get the shot off. So Noah was a great job, and like I said, we had a lot of chances, and that one happened to go for us.
This other question he has here is for everyone. He wants to know, what is your favorite way to pass the time on long road trips? TV, movies, cards, movies, TV shows, what card games, etc.
You guys want to go? Well, for me on the bus, it's just movies. I got like the bed that's right in front of the TV, so with my bunk, I'm just kind of focused on that. Or doing some work, I guess. Read a little bit. I don't read like a lot, but I'll read a book here and there.
No.
Yeah.
Not a reader.
You read the programs.
It was hilarious.
I was debating whether to put that in because I texted him, "What's your favorite book?" And he said, "I don't read." I was like, "So do you want me to put that you don't read as your favorite book, or should I just leave that blank?" Decided to put it in there. People seem to like it. What was his? Oh, that's right. Yeah. That's a good answer. How about you guys?
On the bus, yeah, mm-hmm. Same thing. Movies, TV shows, pretty much any card game. If there's money involved, it's a lot better, but just always competing.
Right. Yeah. No ping pong table on the bus, unfortunately.
No, we might have to set one up in the trailer, though.
Sumi, how about you?
Yeah, the same thing, just movies.
Mm-hmm. Somebody on the team's got to be cards players, I would think.
It's weird. Like, I know when I played, there would be some heavy card games going on, euchre or poker and all that stuff.
Right.
So since I've been coaching, I don't know if it's just these players now, but they rarely play cards. They're on their phones or...
Yeah.
And stuff like that. So, but I don't know. Maybe this year we can get those guys going in the back, play some cards.
Yeah, a generational difference, maybe.
Yeah, I guess we'd have. I'd win a lot of money on road trips back then. So, I don't know.
Going into this weekend's games, what are you stressing towards the team that they need to improve on the most?
Just to build off that last game. I thought that was. Like I said, holding that team under 20 shots and playing a good team defense was huge for us. So I'm going to keep stressing that. And I thought we did a good job getting pucks to the net also and bodies, something that we didn't do enough last year. And you know, I think I got a couple bigger guys this year too. So and some more guys on the back end that actually get the puck to the net. So I'm just going to keep, you know, keep on the guys doing the same thing and keep battling like they did the last game, and we'll win a lot of hockey games this year.
The last question he had was, this is for everyone, what's the most fun thing you did during the off season?
Most fun thing, well, you know, the off season kind of goes by pretty quick when you're working 6 days a week. So I think the funnest part of the off season is just catching up with your family and friends, and I guess seeing my dog. That was probably the biggest part, funnest part, and probably the part I miss most.
Yeah, probably just spending time with my family. But at the same time, every time I go home for, 4 months, after like the first month, I'm pretty excited to come back. And and then probably a lot of time spending with my dog. I adopted a dog in Macon, and then I brought her with me back home. So I was spending a lot of time with her too.
I'm glad you were able to get Bella on the plane, because I know you were having a hard time in the beginning getting her a ticket and everything.
Pretty complicated, but we made it work.
That's awesome. All right, guys, any other questions? Back's been quiet tonight.
No.
Shane, you look like you're just about ready to let loose. Not yet. All right.
We got one.
Okay. Yeah, Bill.
Yeah?
No, it's not going to pick up for the YouTube channel. I'm sorry. Yeah. Sorry about that.
This is for Soaps. Your father was in town this past weekend, and I don't know if a lot of people got to see Soaps Sr., but they look a lot alike. A lot alike. Could you share a story that you and your dad played on people where maybe you were him and he was you?
Yeah, we've never actually really tried one of those stories, but we do get asked all the time, you know, what's the difference in age, and, you know, I always question if I look 50 or not, but I hope not, so I'm not sure who's getting the compliment and who's getting roasted, but I guess we could play one of those tricks.
What was that?
No, I'm not saying there's anything wrong, just when you're 24, it kind of hurts, you know.
Double agree.
And another one. Now that you're rooming with Sumi and our new guy, Timofez Stefan, how is it being with two from other countries? How is it they're rooming with them?
Yeah, English isn't the first language in our apartment. I kind of carry that part, and there's a lot of different foods being cooked, so just trying to get used to that. But it's pretty funny fighting for the remote. Everyone has a different taste in what they want to watch, but they're all becoming Leaf fans, so it's pretty good.
That's good.
All right, this one's for all the guys on stage, but outside your own favorite NHL team, what would you say your favorite player in the league is?
Probably Milan Lucic, Calgary Flames.
Yeah, I'd say John Tavares, Leafs.
My favorite player right now, probably Nathan MacKinnon.
I'll go with Jonathan Taves.
I said outside your favorite team.
Oh, I'm sorry. Patrice Bergeron, Boston.
Yeah, that's a good choice.
Yeah.
I guess you got to pick again, eh? Because that's your.
That's my go-to.
Yeah,
I'd
that's right.
Say, Leo Komarov on the Islanders.
I thought you were gonna say Thomas.
I'm trying to kiss up to you. Get some more ice time, maybe.
Right.
All right. Anything else, guys? Okay, I think we're going to move on to the last section of the show here. Coach, we've got Roanoke on Friday this weekend coming up, Birmingham on Saturday. One team still searching for its first win, the other hoping to sort of reinstate what happened during the preseason game. We saw the Bulls in that exhibition game. Is the opportunity for a rematch that much more exciting now that you've got your roster finalized to take those guys on again?
Yeah, definitely. just them being a top three team in the league, and you know, seeing what I seen in our preseason game and having our full roster now, it's gonna be a fun hockey game. It's gonna be high paced, lots of energy. So, but we've got to take care of Friday, which is Roanoke first, and that's gonna be another hungry team that hasn't won a game yet. And I'm sure they're getting drilled by their coach right now and video and stuff. So they'll be well prepared. And we just got to make sure that we're ready right off the bat.
Yeah, we can definitely expect to see a hungry Roanoke team on Friday night, having just dropped two games down in Pensacola. They got 1 point on the weekend. And then Birmingham, of course, in the preseason game, were definitely pretty impressive, even without Maverick Parks, with former SPHL goaltender of the year having retired. They still looked pretty darn good in net, I would say. So, Coach, that Saturday night also happens to be disco night, by the way. Friday is Harley Davidson night. Have you got your 70s wig and suit picked out yet?
I don't, man. That would actually be pretty funny.
You should.
I'll see what I can do with the afro and the pick or something like that. That'd be pretty funny.
Yes. That's a good question. I would direct that to Zach Smith. He's our director of game ops and community relations. He could answer that for you. I think it's a good idea. Right. Mm-hmm. Definitely. Mm-hmm. I know that we're gonna definitely encourage people to bring their leather jackets out to that game for sure. Leather? Is it leather vests? No. Right. Okay. All right, guys. Last question, as always, it's going to be a trivia question. This one's pretty tough, so I'll be really impressed if anyone's able to get it here. But the question is this. Both of these players, they played on ECHL teams last season. Can you name which teams they played for? You've got the state. Yes. No. He's got his lifeline out. Nope.
You guys need a hint?
You guys have been getting you guys have been getting Stathises.
Their jerseys are black and gold. Black and gold.
Now, whoever can guess Soper's, whatever Soper played, they win.
They're affiliated with the Toronto Maple Leafs.
Yep.
You only get one more hint after this.
Do you want to give the last hint?
They won the championship last year in the East Coast.
Yep. Okay, now it's a race. It's a race to Google. It was too good of a question. You guys are too smart. Last year they were just too easy. No, think the opposite side, the opposite coast. It's in Canada.
That was going to be my next.
Yeah. Another hint. Nope. Other coast. East Coast. Yeah, East Coast. What's that? No. It's their affiliate in the ECHL. You're getting closer. Yes.
There you go.
There we go.
Newfoundland.
Is it Newfoundland or Newfoundland? Yeah. It's Newfoundland?
Newfoundland.
That's what I thought, too. All right, well, congratulations. These two are going to sign a puck for you. What's that? Yeah, he did, yeah.
Growlers.
So we're going to get these two to sign a puck for you. In the meantime, guys, thanks so much for coming to our second episode of Season 2 of Line Change. Newfoundland, or Newfoundland, however you say it. Newfoundland Growlers. We hope you've enjoyed your meals, and we hope to see you again next Tuesday night. It's going to be 6 p.m. Every Tuesday right here at the Rookery. So thank you, guys. We'll see you next week.